NVIDIA just surpassed Apple as the world's second most valuable company. If we ask around, people are more likely to recognize Apple as the company that gave us the smartphone. However, NVIDIA is defining the next wave with their groundbreaking hardware. They're even being investigated for monopoly practice because of CUDA, though that's unlikely to result in anything. Meanwhile, NVIDIA will be a dominant force and is here to stay. I'm familiar with Omniverse, their GPUs, and GeForce Experience, but you also have AI Enterprise, Broadcast, cuDNN, DeepStream, iRay, Maxine, Merlin, Metropolis, Nemo, Ensight, Grid, Isaac, CUDA, Rapids, Riva, TensorRT, and Triton. Not to mention others I won't even be covering in this video. Today we're going to skim these programs and see if any could be useful in my tech stack. We're going to cover a lot, so hang tight. The company has shipped products from low-level libraries to creator tools since Curtis Priam, Jensen Huang, and Chris Malachowski started it in 1993. It took them 2 years to release their first product, the NV1. It wasn't popular, but a step toward their breakthrough, the GeForce line of GPUs. Many innovations would happen between then and now, but CUDA is notable. The Compute Unified Device Architecture is a way to use NVIDIA hardware to accelerate computing. By accessing the GPU's more numerous cores, applications can be executed with parallelism. They can be written in C, C++, and Python. In some cases, CUDA allows greater than 100x performance improvement. Now, take that 100x improved application. If we run Ensight, we can visualize its algorithms, identify the largest optimization opportunities, and tune it to scale efficiently across any quantity or size of CPUs and GPUs. If that's not enough performance, you can get virtual GPUs through NVIDIA Grid. Data science and AI use up a lot of compute. So using CUDA, NVIDIA made a data science and AI library named Rapids. Rapids integrates with Apache Spark and Pandas. Now you don't even need to define the functions yourself, just call them. Similarly, NVIDIA cuDNN is a deep learning library. It contains standard routines such as forward and backward convolution, attention, matmul, pooling, and normalization. It's a part of frameworks like TensorFlow, PyTorch, and Caffe. If you want to focus on deep learning for speech inference, TensorRT provides APIs to assist with LLMs, chatbots, and translation. Then, you can make an AI girlfriend with Nemo and have her recommend relevant ads to you with Merlin. Your girlfriend will need a home, in other words, a host. You can put her on AWS, or you could use Triton. Triton allows one to run models on different server hardware. When the metaverse is built, it'll probably exist on top of Omniverse, a 3D platform for building and sharing 3D assets. Omniverse is built on Pixar's Universal Scene Description, a more complete 3D file when compared to .fbx or .obj files. Omniverse has connectors to import and export scenes from most, if not all, 3D software. Its physics-based rendering engine is iRay. iRay can also be found in Maya and Substance Designer. When you upload your consciousness to the metaverse, you'll need someone to maintain your physical body. Isaac enables this by teaching robots perception, simulation, and manipulation. You could build an inference model yourself, but why do that when there's DeepStream? This deep learning framework for vision speeds up development of image recognition and pose estimation. On the consumer side, NVIDIA offers Broadcast, an AI feature layer for recording and streaming. With it, you can blur your background, remove background noise, and even center your eyes on the camera. While all of that sounds great, I did experience less than ideal results when testing it. Maxine lets you add AR effects and augment quality when recording, which sounds like Broadcast. While Maxine has the same eye focus, it does offer a pretty cool language translation. If you don't want to build your own speech features, Riva offers out-of-the-box speech recognition and text-to-speech. Metropolis is yet another platform for doing object recognition on video feeds. With Metropolis, videos can be analyzed for inventory management, traffic, access control, smart buildings, inspection, safety, and even patient monitoring. AI Enterprise is a suite of programs. It has NIMS and AI workflows. NIMS are a Docker container and a machine learning model. The model can be in the Docker container or on a server. There are NIMs for automatic speech recognition, biology, generative AI, genomics, LLMs, and medical imaging. So here we are in Figma. I'm going to cover the tech stack now. So at a simple level, this is basically my tech stack. It's a Django and Next app, and these are both frameworks for the languages of the backend and frontend. And then even though you have a backend with functions specified, you need a database. So you have your Postgres database where data is stored, and all of that's going to get hosted on a cloud. The clouds allow you to scale up and scale down your hardware so that you're not stuck into whatever hardware you buy. And also you could use it effectively over time if your demand changes. So that's going to be, those clouds are going to be Azure and Vercel. I could do everything through Azure, and I'm not set on doing it this way yet, but Vercel does simplify the hosting of a Next app on the front end. And I just value that because the deployment and the build step can be a headache at times. It's doable, but just having someone that simplifies that for free is very nice. So if you're interested in going into further detail, we can do that. So there are things within the weeds. For example, even though Django is a framework, we could talk about like what that is a framework of, which is Python, the programming language. And then if you want to do machine learning, which my app is a text to 3D model generator, then you can use either TensorFlow or PyTorch. I'm using PyTorch. And then if you're going to be transmitting data back and forth between a front end and back end, you'll probably do it through HTTP requests, which is where Postman comes in. Postman allows you to test these as you're creating APIs, and it simplifies the process instead of having to manually do that, which I find very useful. And then I also use GitHub Actions as a way of setting up automated continuous integration, continuous development. This just means that when I build the project, or not when I build it, but when I save the project and push it to GitHub, then whenever GitHub is updated, it auto builds the project so that the backend on the server is reflected. So that automation saves time. And then if you're going to host, or like if you're going to have a server anywhere, you may use Gunicorn and Nginx in order to publish your website. And I don't have much experience doing that outside of a cloud, but I did do it through Azure. So a little bit familiar with that process. And I've done it like through Azure, but through AWS, and it's very similar no matter which one you're using. So you just have to configure your settings and connect it to Django in the proper way. And yeah, so then that's the back end. If we go to the front end, I am using a framework for CSS called StyleX, made by Facebook. And I know a lot of people use Tailwind, which is a little bit older but more established. But I find StyleX's pro is that it's more flexible because you don't have the already built-in library of classes. You also don't have to learn a Tailwind way of doing anything. StyleX is very close to JavaScript and CSS. And then also with StyleX, your CSS is put into your JavaScript. And I think that having like your HTML and your CSS in your JavaScript as like one is making more sense to me. Not that you can't, like obviously having things in three different locations has its pros too, but I do see a benefit sometimes to having like your everything on one page, and you don't have to like jump around to see what file is being referenced. But you're always going to have different files that do different things. So I'm not really stuck on StyleX, but like this is my current solution for a CSS framework, and I'm pretty happy with it. React is a, so like if you're making a Next app, it's Next is going to be built on top of React, which is built on top of TypeScript, which is a type checker for JavaScript. So all of this is just like workflow speed ups for writing in JavaScript, which is the only language that the browser accepts. So I actually would prefer that the browser doesn't work on JavaScript. I would prefer it work on a language that has inherent type safety so that we don't have to have like this TypeScript linter on top of your language. But that's the current state of things. So I know there are things like WebAssembly where like experimenting with getting Python to be inside the browser, but it's nowhere near ready for like widespread use. And then lastly is just Webpack, which is like how the website is built. And that's what I'm currently using. I know some people prefer other ones, but I haven't experimented enough to have a preference here. I'm just doing like the most default thing. So that's the weeds of my current tech stack. And then these are the NVIDIA products that I thought were interesting and where I thought that they could be used. So going top down, Insight is just for general profiling and like speed up performance improvements, finding the bottleneck. Of course, that could be useful. cuDNN and Rapids is, since I said I was doing machine learning, these are frameworks for machine learning, and I would have to get further experience with them to see exactly how they could help. But they just pique my interests in being frameworks, just like in the other parts of my tech stack where I have frameworks to speed up the workflow. These may allow me to do that. I know with like PyTorch, I can even like access neural nets and like recurrent neural nets or like different models that are pre-built, and that just goes so far. That's not even like a speed up thing. That's just like a like years saved of like low level research that I would have to do myself. So if cuDNN and Rapids could provide something along those levels, then that would be amazing. In the same boat, I'm doing machine learning, but I'm doing text to 3D model. And by doing text to 3D model, you need to have machine learning to generate a 3D model, but you need to also translate that into the English language. And since that's the case, and I may need a chatbot or like an LLM, Merlin and Nemo seemed interesting to me for their text synthesization and generation. So I'm interested in going further in those. And then at the lowest level, you have the AI Enterprise, NVIDIA Grid, and the Triton Reference Server, Inference Server. And what these all seem to be is like ways of partitioning hardware to do what you want. I mean, AI Enterprise is more of a platform, but like when you start to into like think of them all as one, they start to be reminiscent of something like AWS or Azure. So I'm curious if once I enroll in AI Enterprise, if I'm just gonna realize that like there was a hidden Azure that I wasn't aware of, or if it's that NVIDIA is developing all of these separate services to be a platform as a service, and they're just in the early stage of that. Like I know when I enrolled into Omniverse, no one knows what Omniverse is because you have to like enroll into it as a business, but once you do, then the doors are open and you have all of these incredible features that are just being developed in like secret right now so that they can really polish it before they start advertising it more widely. That may be the case for AI Enterprise, I don't know. So, NVIDIA's platform is more comprehensive than I originally thought. I now see them up there with Azure and AWS. Maybe they're closer to GCP. Let me know if you want a follow-up video where I do the same for the other platform as a service providers. Also, check out this video where I review NVIDIA Omniverse.